Hi everyone. Thanks for being here. I'm just going to get into it. So I would often be woken up by my father. Groggy-eyed, I would stumble into the shower, come out, and find breakfast already waiting for me at the table. I could hear my father in the kitchen cooking, pots clanging, packing me my lunchbox, occasionally telling me, "Tasneem, hurry up." This was a pretty usual morning in my life while growing up. But for my school friends, who I shared this wonderful lunchbox with, this was quite unusual. You know, men in India, they're not supposed to be in the kitchen. I really do think the country would fall apart if the women just disappeared for one day. So it was only when I went into the outside world, I realized this was quite rare. What others were calling an involved father, we've all heard this, right? I was simply calling a parent. So today I'm here to talk to you about the power of parents, to share with you three things that they did differently, three things that highlight their resilience and hence my privilege, three things that I identify as feminist parenting. So the first one being respect. Now it sounds super obvious, but let me go further. For young people in India, autonomy is not a given. Norms valuing male seniority dictate much of a woman's life. I was fortunate. I never had to fight for my autonomy inside my home, and my parents did a great job of defending it to the outside world. So they let me wear my preferred boys' clothing when I was 2, and let me choose my own name when I was 6. They really went so far to respect both the autonomy of my mind and my body. Now, I always wonder, how did 2 people who grew up in the ghetto come to go against the norm like this? And that brings me to my second point. Resist. So, you know, people in India are very generous, and I know I'm making some generalizations here, but they spend hours looking out for other people's children, which basically means they're policing their behavior. So, lo kya kahenge, or what will people say or think, defines the actions of many in the country. I think what my parents did well was really resist against this everyday judgment. So, they still get asked today, how will your daughter ever find a husband if you raise her like this? And this is still a question both for me and my sister that my parents get asked. As if I waited my whole life leading up to this moment where this hypothetical husband is going to come and save me. That's bizarre, right? So, that is bizarre. And my parents were great. They totally shut these comments down. But you know, you don't make friends very easily when you do it this way. So luckily now that my sister and I are older, we really back each other up. And we sort of work as a team. And I was talking about this to my parents, and I really wonder, they didn't grow up with so much socioeconomic capital. And I was like, where did you get these crazy ideas of this alternative parenting? And I think what they did really well was imagine, and that's my third point. They really used art, music, and poetry, which was booming when they were growing up in India, very accessible, and books, to really question the status quo, and they totally redefined what it means to raise 2 daughters in a country like India. So they often say, if you want a tigress, you can't raise a cat at home. And so we were both allowed to argue, push back, resist, question, and today we claim that space. I argue that it's important that women in India occupy public space, that we are seen, we are visible, we have the right to take risks and to move around the cities and towns that we grew up in. So, on a more serious note, when I look back today, you know, their actions were quite everyday, my parents. They were small, almost mundane. But you know, you put them together and their sum was monumental. I don't think my parents knew what feminism was. But today, as a young person working in this field in gender equality, I can say that if there was any lens in their way of working, it was a feminist one. And it is really this everyday nature of resistance that is at the heart of feminist parenting. I don't think there's this list of actions that you can take and you can do to be a good feminist parent. I mean, there isn't one to be a parent either, right? So it is really this lens of reflexivity and of autonomy that is really at the center. And you can celebrate all your difficult multiple identities, and you can even choose to be emancipated from them. And I think that's really what my parents and many other parents that I know around me try to do. So it goes far beyond this idea that a man cooking in the kitchen is something new or something novel, because if that's the case, I think we're setting our bar a bit too low. Now, if my parents hear me talking like this, they will think I'm intellectualizing this like way too much. And maybe I am, right? But today in my work on youth and sexuality, I really see how this resonates. I work across countries and different contexts as a researcher, and they're very different, but there's one striking similarity. You guessed it right. The role of parents is undoubtedly very powerful. How can we leverage and support parents who take small actions, small steps for their well-being of their kids? Maybe they pay the fee of their daughters to school. Maybe they defend their daughters every day at home. How can we leverage these and amplify them? How can we enable them to respect, resist, and imagine new possibilities so that women and girls around them can enjoy the same equal rights? I think this needs to be part of our discussion when we design interventions so that we can raise a generation of feminists, yes, but also feminist parents who choose to be, so that a father in the kitchen is seen as the bare minimum, and only if he's making an exquisite feast, I might think of it as revolutionary. Thank you so much. Oh, I have to stand here.
Don't go away yet.
I was ready. I'm ready.
Thank you so much, Tasneem.
Thank you.
And I think for a lot of us doing the work that we do, sometimes parents are the challenge. So as a parent myself, it's nice to see that sometimes we can be part of the solution. So
yeah.
Thank you very much for sharing that. So tell us how you will spread this power of parents and what you think is most important as you continue your journey here at Women Deliver.
Yeah, and I think actually you already said some of it when you were explaining it, that sometimes we underestimate the power that parents have because they are and they can be a very challenging factor. So really my kind of message throughout this conference since yesterday has been that, hey, let's reconsider the possibility that parents can actually do a lot of good here. And let's keep that part of the conversation, because we think about religious leaders and we think about healthcare workers, and they're all very important, but I feel like so much starts at home. And maybe we should reconsider going back to that a bit. And I think that's really, and I think saying that as a young person and not saying that as a parent also has a bit of an added value. And I really think that's what I want to do for the next, well, one day that remains.
Thank you. Thank you, Tasneem.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.